ethics, my job is to remove plausible deniability from people. So I could say when, like, they can't at some point say, we didn't know, because I'm like, I tried to tell you. Like, here's the documentation of how I tried to tell you. So, you know, early on, I watched Citizen Four, which, you know, I was sort of, you know, this, I'm the activism, and I seen, you know, Laura Poitras's documentary on this, on Snowden, and Greenwald is a central character in this, Greenwald. And, you know, I was totally bought in. I was totally bought in. And then I started following the money with my education research. And I realized, actually, it was an event at the Philadelphia Free Library where Snowden did a simulcast, and Jeremy Scahill of The Intercept was the facilitator. And so I ended up, I was very excited. I talked to him about ed tech and surveillance and all this stuff. And afterwards, someone pointed out, they're like, you know, what about Omidyar Network? And I was like, oh, that's right. And I hadn't really done my homework before. And what I realized is, like, Omidyar Network owns The Intercept, like, full out. It wasn't like Omidyar Network, like, Pierre Omidyar gives some grants to The Intercept. He literally owns it, which was Glenn's longtime employer, who is, he since left, but many, many years. And so once I realized that Omidyar Network, which is advancing good identity, digital identity, microfinance, ed tech, social entrepreneurship, social impact investing, specifically targeting the global South, but also, you know, low-income communities worldwide, that he was behind this. And I'm like, well, The Intercept is never going to cover the problems of surveillance and educational technology, because Pierre Omidyar, that's what he's setting it all up. Like, this is not going to be an issue. The Intercept can cover many other issues well, but they're not ever going to touch on this. So that was sort of my frame of, like, okay, so this isn't all, like, the Snowden leaks were intercepted. You know, The Intercept is an intercept, you know, in and of itself. And so I was more critical, but that's a learning process. We all have to go through these learning processes. So what came up, I'm not sure how long ago, within the past couple of weeks, is that it was announced that Jack Dorsey, formerly of Twitter and Square, a tech billionaire, was funding the construction of a rec center project in Rio de Janeiro in one of the favelas. And Glenn Greenwald's husband is an elected official there, left-leaning, I think socialist. And there was concern within the socialist community about the use of essentially sort of billionaire neoliberal money flowing into this project. And then Glenn Greenwald was very affronted by the whole thing. Granted, I will say some of the critiques were inappropriate. They were homophobic. They made insinuations that were inappropriate. And then a number of them, like, were concerns about this outside money from the global north flowing into these communities and the amount of transparency and accountability that was connected to the project, which I think in some ways he did address. But the elephant in the room that was not addressed by anyone besides me was, where is this project in the context of social impact investing and human capital finance in Brazil? Because I had Brazil on my radar for the past several years, looking at IO2 Foundation, which is also known as Shanzai City. And they are a key player in linking digital identity and conditional cash transfers, which are essentially like UBI. It's going to be the precursor to that. So, like, subsidy payments to low-income families, linking it to home visits and, like, essentially digital surveillance of low-income people tied to early childhood education. And so the mayor of Boa Vista, Brazil, which is a rural area, it's not in Rio, it's in a different part of the country, but they actually attended this event in 2018 in New York City around early childhood investing and human capital finance that was sponsored by Ready Nation. And at the time, it was like in the fall of 2018, they rang the NASDAQ bell. They were like, we're so excited that people are actually, capital is investing in early childhood and workforce training opportunities. And this is all linked to digital identity and impact markets. So I'd had Brazil on my radar for quite some time. UNICEF was involved in this. And we know that, like, once UNICEF comes online, like, they can scale it through their innovation fund globally very quickly. And so I was trying to press this issue. I was like, Glenn Greenwald, where do you stand on social impact finance? Can you just make a public statement? Like, it's not strictly about this project, but clearly if his role was in the he gave an interview later with someone, his name is Andre Domis, I think, who's like a Marxist in, I believe it sounded like he was in Toronto, Canadian, came from like a Jamaican family. And so they're having this conversation. In this conversation, like essentially Glenn Greenwald was like, well, after the framing of this was that there had been a mass shooting by the police of residents of this favela under the guise of like coming in and, you know, bringing, you know, rogue actors in, but like it was done indiscriminately. It caused a lot of harm. It was state violence enacted on this low-income population. And it was where Glenn Greenwald's husband, Dave Mirandola, I think, like grew up. And so he had these connections. And so he came in and he said, we're going to sort of help this community. What do you need? How about this rec center? Why don't you put together a design for this rec center for the youth, because they don't have anything and the state has abandoned them, which is true, right? Like, I mean, it's a favela, like the state is missing in action. And so, and then Glenn, he says that he regularly goes to these very affluent Silicon Valley people with requests for financial support, and that Jack Dorsey of Twitter and Square, now Block, offered to fund the construction of the program. And it sounds like there are several programs. Like they have, this isn't the only one, they're going to build several. And so the build out was like, how could one ever question this charity for these people who have been abandoned by the state, by the billionaire class? And how could anyone imply that there was a way to for money to be made at this? Which to me is shocking, because Glenn Greenwald, I mean, he advances himself as this very worldly individual, very knowledgeable about geopolitics. How could Glenn Greenwald not know about social impact finance and human capital investing? I mean, I can understand maybe he doesn't know all the nuts and bolts of it, but if someone raises this question and says, well, what about digital identity in Brazil? How is this going to be linked to potentially out of school time, education training, workforce training of what they call opportunity youth, which are youth like 16 to 24. Because if you understand, like I had gone over in my talk, that they want the youth to code the metaverse. And they especially want Black and brown youth, in my opinion, to do that coding work. They want, because on the one hand, it's a great social impact opportunity. And on the other hand, symbolically, it's like severing this tie to the natural world of people who are more like have this cultural connection to life, and making them code the counterfeit, and making it sound fun, like a video game, which is very Ready Player One. And then I would say too, in the favelas, there's such a concentration of population that once they create the impact markets, they can scale them pretty quickly and actually get quite a big impact on the data dashboards that we're talking about, to create these profit centers and to create the gaming. And you know, Rio is a smart city. They're advancing a lot of surveillance networks. Ready Nation has a footprint. Actually, Aspen Institute had done a mapping of social impact investment opportunities in Brazil in 2014. So quite some time ago, they were already mapping out what the opportunity space were for the investment markets. And Omidyar Network, who at the time was Glenn Greenwald's, Pierre Omidyar was Glenn Greenwald's employer, was a party to that research that Omidyar Network was doing, I mean, that was being done in Brazil, that Aspen Institute was doing. And then another player in the space is actually Stanford. So Stanford has a special focus on education entrepreneurship, targeting Brazil specifically for ed tech development. And then, you know, they're layering in programs around social impact finance and education, and specifically like programs around digital world building and the metaverse in 2015. I mean, it's, you know, in Second Life. So this stuff didn't just show up. And so what I was trying to pressure Glenn Greenwald was to say, if you and your husband are essentially soliciting money on behalf of this program, which again, he's framing as that communities have a say, but again, does the community have informed consent? Has anyone talked to the community about what this landscape of social impact finance? Because I sort of frame it as like, It's like, you know, the local drug dealer, right? Like you hooked, and you know, maybe with free or like low cost drugs, and then they reel you in, and that's what this predatory philanthropy does. It's not right, and none of this can be ignored because it's right in your face. And I provided many, many links, none of which he responded to, and in the end, none of it was discussed in the interview, which I clipped. It was about a 40-minute discussion. Social impact finance came up, none of it. The interviewer nor Glenn talked about it. And it needs to be unpacked because Brazil is a center for cryptocurrency as well. My friend Raul from Silicon Icarus, he had a tweet today or yesterday about, I think it's T2 or 2T, which is a Brazilian-based, blockchain-based company. And that's gonna be layered in with the smart contracts in the police state. So, you know, they would love for the kids, the youth in Brazil to sit in their, you know, maybe have a community center where they can do esports and power the metaverse and get the data impact markets for the social impact investors in Silicon Valley, where Jack Dorsey has a donor advised fund in the Silicon Valley Community Foundation, which is partnered with, you know, right there with Stanford. And they're the ones who are, it's creating a market. They are market shaping, and it's not benevolent. It's absolutely not benevolent. So this is a much bigger conversation to be had. This is the Aspen Institute report. This was 2014, so it's mapping the sector. So these are investors that are eyeing up what their opportunities are going to be. And, you know, I don't need to go into it in deep detail, but there, if you go further down, I think there is a partnership, like Omidyar Network, if you scan to the slide of, like, who is involved in the program, Omidyar is, there you go. It's at the bottom line there. There's that on-off button again, right? O-N, Omidyar Network. And at the time, in 2014, Glenn Greenwald was still at The Intercept, and that was exclusively, like, funded by Pierre Omidyar. So for, you know, he, to me, it seems like he has no excuse, even if maybe he didn't know it before, when someone starts to share this information and to press on this issue, that there should be some level of engagement. And I think what was so frustrating to me was that the interview that he did, the first half an hour or so, was all about censorship and gatekeeping and controlling the narrative. When Omidyar Network is a central player in setting up, you know, credentialed news and fake news and trusted sources in the media. And I know he's not there anymore, but to me, it was very deceptive to have, like, essentially create your career in alignment with an individual who is doing the very same gatekeeping, and then saying that you would engage in good faith with people. And I agree, not all of the comments were appropriate, and some of them were off the mark, but mine weren't. Mine were actually very much on the mark, and he didn't reply before the interview to any of the links that I sent. And I did follow up after the interview and commented, and he had very, very snarky responses and said that no one was, like, entitled to sort of a personal response. It was just in the interview, which it was not. The interview covered none of this social impact finance in Brazil. This is the pilot that was in Boa Vista. Again, not Rio de Janeiro. This is a rural area. But if they can set up these social impact pilots where they're coming into people's homes to track their parenting behavior with iPads and use that for social impact market, if they can do it in a small town, Boa Vista, they can do it in Rio as well. And I will say, if, you know, maybe we can include some of these links in the description afterwards if people want to poke around themselves. But it's very invasive. But what they need is, they're going to need people on the blockchain with digital identities. And this was tied to low-income people on this Bolsa Familia program, which was a conditional cash transfer. And that conditional cash transfer, that's going to be programmable money on the blockchain in the future. And so this is all getting underway. And it's appropriate context. It was an appropriate ask for me to inquire as to his position and awareness of these programs in Brazil.
Okay. Here's the next link.
Tech Roundup. So again, Brazil. This is coming up, like, this month. So, you know, what do they need to scale these programs? Well, they need everyone to have digital identity cards. And, you know, it's hard to say. I know in the U.S., very likely the children's educational systems, these digital vouchers will be tied to digital identity. But, you know, in the United States, what they call out-of-school time learning, which is the kind of learning that they would offer in these rec centers, both, you know, athletic skills. Glenn Greenwald, he spoke very, you know, he said multiple times that this was about them learning English. So again, I keep talking about this as a colonizing project, that the goal is to get these children ready to compete in the global economy, and to get them geared up for their educational opportunities. That I in the U.S., the YMCA and the Boys and Girls Clubs are very central to both online blended learning and impact investing. And so, and I know that the United Way is a key player here. The United Way is also involved in the impact space and opportunity youth in Brazil, but they need the digital identity. And there it is, like there's the proof that they're rolling out the government ID. Again, the conditional cash transfers. That's, you know, if they can put you out of independent, having an independent economic opportunities, and then tie you into, this is the, I think, the World Bank. Jason, am I right? Is that a World Bank page?
Yes, it is.
The World Bank gets to govern whether or not you eat, right? And the World Bank and the investors get to determine if the way you parent your children is, it fits in with their model of, you know, global digital citizenship and that sort of thing. So, the conditional cash transfer actually came, like, originated sort of out of pay for performance, pay for good behavior, from Michael Bloomberg in New York. And then there was a program in Mexico called, I think, Oportunidades, and in Boa Vista. And then there's like 40 different countries that have these conditional cash transfers, but these will be melded with the digital ID.
And this is SoftBank.
Yeah, yeah. So I think, can you remind me, that does it say the name of the company? Is it T2 or 2T?
2TM. This is the one
that, 2TM. Okay, 2TM. So yeah, so Raul Diego, he goes at Hijo del Cuervo on Twitter. Like, he tweeted this link yesterday. You know, it's global, right? It's about global, recycling global capital. SoftBank is backing one of the largest innovation funds in AI and robotics and cryptocurrency. So the conditional cash transfers and the behavioral tokenized payments, the tokenization of everything, you know, the capital is going to flow for where they see the good opportunities. Aspen Institute has marked out what the opportunities are. And then the cryptocurrency space, again, we need to understand that, you know, money as we understand it, most people understand it, except for, unless you're Jason and you know it's freedom tokens, is going to be changing, right? It's going to be changing. The innovation elements are, you know, SoftBank is based in Japan, although I think that this division, role said, is actually, the person is based out of Miami. So, you know, again, nothing is isolated in this cloud-based world. Everything is interconnected and networked, everything. And it's all about circulating the investments, the global investments, and the concentrating the power.
Okay, this is a Verge, a Jack Dorsey article.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, this is the benefactor, the billionaire benefactor, who's you know, going to fund the creation of this rec center, and then, you know, there's a couple more in the pipeline. I don't know if he's funding those rec centers, but you know, he's also connected to the digital payment space that has now just pivoted to blockchain. And again, it's behavioral script coming. And, you know, he has his donor advised fund in the Silicon Valley Community Foundation, which is actually a real sketchy sort of slush fund for a lot of crypto assets. And we need to understand that the smart contracts, the payment systems are going to be tied to the identity. So again, is this first project fully charitable, no strings attached? That's what they say. That's what they say. I have no reason to believe differently. But if we understand that the Global North has a profound interest, the Silicon Valley, in the data analytics, and that's, again, ironically, like, I'm on Twitter a lot, but Twitter is very much about mapping network and the data analytics. This is about data. Jack Dorsey's out of school time learning for the youth of favelas in Rio de Janeiro is about market shaping for human capital finance. So this first project, which my understanding is it's like $250,000. Like, I mean, I can't even imagine what a tiny pittance that is to this guy. So, you know, keep an eye out. He can afford to drop a lot more than that to set up to my way of thinking. Once you understand it's about data analytics tied to digital identity and behavioral compliance, it's a mining program. It is a human capital mining program, which is very much in alignment with resource extraction in Brazil. Oh. Like, we know the history of this. It's an extractive, colonizing, predatory system. And the mining system, which is what digital identity and conditional cash transfer and online digital learning and esports and metaverse gaming and coding and the stuff that, you know, who knows? Like, I'm fully, you know, willing to sit back and see what kind of rec center this ends up being. But if we're not actually talking about that these are problematic things on the horizon, what's to stop it from happening? And the inability and unwillingness of prominent individuals who should know better and who should be willing in good faith to engage in the conversations, the fact that they will not, says a lot to me.
I remember John Trudell said that, I wish I had the clip, but he's like, they're mining you. They're mining you. And this was back early 90s. Anyways, yeah, he was pretty prophetic. So the next one here is...
He knew. Yeah, so this is Stanford. And I remember, you know, it's interesting. I got invited, it's weird, by into a, like, it was like a conference or something. Lapes? It was like the Latin American sort of like socialist educational group. And I thought it was like a big conference, but it turns out when I went, it was sponsored by Westchester University. And it was really just a couple dozen people from Philly. And then all these people from Silicon Valley, like the Bay Area educational institutions. And I was trying, you know, me, like, I'm like, it's XAPI. It's about tracking data. It's about human capital finance. And they did not really like they, except for the person who had invited me. And I'm sure like this person got a talking to afterwards, like they did not want to engage. And, you know, afterwards, this person actually had ties to Brazil. And so I found this Lehman Center at Stanford, and I'm like, wow, it's like education, entrepreneurship, and technology. Like, this is everything I was talking about. Like, this is something you guys need to pay attention to. This is a problem. And, you know, like nobody really wants to talk about that. But it's Silicon Valley has had its eye on Brazil's youth for quite some time. They, like, you know, up here, they're reimagining education. And I talked about that very clearly in this last segment about reimagining education for data-driven, badge-based, behaviorist learning. But it's not just here. They're interested in reinventing people all over the place. And again, if you target the favelas community, because it's, you know, they're tight packed. There's a lot of people in there. If you can figure out a way to get your infrastructure in to mine that, which rec centers could very well be, rec centers with QR codes and digital identity systems and badges and getting that social emotional learning data and the teamwork data and the entrepreneurial spirit data into the system, like that's going to be very profitable for impact investors. So, you know, I think it's really important to know, not everyone would know about the Lehman Center and Stanford in Brazil.
Yeah.
But no comment from Glenn Greenwald on any of these things. You know, I don't bring things up unless I actually know what I'm talking about. I have a lot of material. And in fact, Stanford, again, they were looking at youth. Greenwald, in that interview, he talked, I can't remember the funder, but that there was a young person who set up their own media outlet, like a youth voice media outlet. So I like the idea of youth voice for sure. But, you know, the youth, and that's the thing with the whole, like, if you look back at the whole Greta movement, is that disconnecting youth from community and elders, the youth don't really have a lot of life experience. And they're not necessarily going to think that everybody's out to get them, right? Like, they're not going to imagine that someone who's, like, setting them up with their own program is, it has a nefarious rationale behind it. But I can't remember in the interview, Glenn said they got, like, gave the kid $1 million or something. I mean, it's absurd. Not that the youth shouldn't have these opportunities, but even UNICEF has their own whole youth media outlets. And so it's about controlling the narrative and bringing the children up in a certain way of thinking so that they grow up in a certain box and they're not really empowered to think outside the box that they're given. You know, they're given resources, but they're going to be conditional. Like, that's the game here. And so, you know, Stanford is involved in that. And I think if you click forward, there's one more.
I came up with a term, gratification. Yeah. No.
Okay. You know, and all for the youth, like they should be empowered, but not by the impact investors. They should be empowered by their communities, and they should be like connected intergenerationally, because that is where the strength of community is an intergenerational learning, not separate spinning youth out and then lifting them up and having them become fodder for these solutions journalism markets. Yeah, so this is the impact report specifically on the favelas of Rio de Janeiro, engaging, empowering, and enabling youth to lead. Again, Stanford, right? So, you know, Greenwald is supposed to know about neoliberalism, right? And in fact, even in this interview, like he acknowledges, I mean, his frame is essentially the world is just really, really messed up. So it's only a place of privilege to say we shouldn't be taking money from neoliberal billionaires because we really have no other choice. And again, I think that maybe goes back to your, you know, abolition framing, right? Like revolution or abolition is like, are we reaching this model or do we have to have something completely different? And then if we're going with the tweaking model, which is the Greenwaldian, you know, neoliberal tech billionaire funding your youth program, you're training the youth to essentially be dependent on the tech billionaires, which I guess, you know, I give it to the interviewers, even though the interviewer, Andre, he didn't go into any of the impact space. He never responded to any of my questions about the impact, but he did push back on Greenwald about the neoliberalism and about like, once you go down this road, as I always say, pay for success finance, human capital finance is predicated on austerity and starving accountable, ostensibly elected officials from ever being responsible to do what they're supposed to do, which is to provide the services that people need. And that austerity is a precondition for the public-private partnership for the data surveillance of low-income people. So, yeah, I mean, clearly Stanford knows what's going on. And it is irresponsible and not fulfilling the fiduciary duty of these two individuals to ignore this. They can't ignore it. And I'm showing up to say, like, I told you, and everyone who is like some big fan of these people needs or not needs to pressure them, because how do we actually move forward if people don't understand the game that we're in? And it's a game. It's a terrible, brutal, ugly game. And it's been going on for a long time. I mean, it's been going on. So, you know, they're trying to figure out a way of working out social impact bonds in Brazil. This is from 2016. They said, they haven't quite figured, the first trial run didn't go so well, but they're going to need the digital ID and the conditional programmable money. That's about all I got on here. And Ready Nation, which I mentioned, Boa Vista, that had the home visit pilot, the mayor of Boa Vista, Brazil, went to the Ready Nation conference in 2018, and they rang the NASDAQ bell. And they said, like, great, we're investing in early childhood and workforce training for youth, which is what these centers will evolve into once you get them hooked in. And I suspect, you know, if it follows the model of the Global North, is that you will get the youth in, and then you will get their families, and then we get that data, and then you will start putting the families on programs like health programs, mm-hmm. wellness programs, financial management programs, food assistance programs, but all of it being conditional and tied into the impact markets. Ready Nation is actually, oh, can we go back one second before on the Ready Nation? It's part of something, no, you were good, tied with something into called Council for a Strong America. Council for a Strong America is a really creepy organization. And Ready Nation is one of five program areas that they have. The five areas are essentially, their goal is to train the youth, and this is global, to be in alignment, behaviorally conditioned and accepting of the police, the military, the workforce, which is Ready Nation, chambers of commerce, and evangelical Christianity, specifically evangelical Christianity, and athleticism. And so once you know that, like if the entry point is, you know, these rec centers, right, athletics that kids, you know, a lot of kids like, especially if they're trapped inside and they need to get out and exercise, but feeding into these other five areas, which are hugely problematic. And again, I think like from an identity point, like Glenn Greenwald was trying to make it about, you know, and some of the critiques again were inappropriate about him, you know, like homophobia, but Ready Nation is in Brazil and they're connected with evangelical Christianity, which is highly problematic in that space. So, you know, we need to actually look at what's going on and not be so strident and attacking people who are raising serious issues, because this is a very serious issue. And I would really encourage people to look at Council for a Strong America, because in that space, Jim Heckman, who is the Heckman equation, is what's driving all of this, at least in early childhood. You know, someone brought up the military readiness of the this was in the United States, but like, oh, well, maybe people would fund pre-K if they found out that people weren't passing the SVAB test, which is the Army like military vocational like training, like the standardized testing for the military. If they didn't know, if they were seeing that people, that the youth of today were not equipped to drive the new tanks, then they might invest in pre-K so that they could do this. Part of what I talked about in this this episode, this last final episode, was about Epic Games and, you know, the Unreal Engine and coding video games, that this guy Megan wanted all of the youth to code his games, which the games are the virtual world. The games are the virtual world. And a lot of this is happening in esports. And, you know, so my question in these rec centers is, eventually, is the model going to actually have a robust in-person sporting program? Or due to, you know, pandemic surveillance requirements, are they going to encourage kids to, like, maybe, you know, hang out in different pods and play virtual soccer, you know, virtual football? You know, this soccer and esports, that's how you do it. You create a biosurveillance state and you say you can't bring people together, and then you get their health impact data and their biosensor data. So the e-sporting and the gaming in youth culture is already embedded in that space. And so if you start to essentially come in and say, well, we're here to train the youth, like, is that what the rec center is going to, like, maybe not this first one, maybe the first couple will actually have real soccer fields, and maybe the 10th one will, but will the 20th, if we know that the future is esports and gaming and keeping people locked up to be able to get their data captured, which is exactly what Silicon Valley wants, and to feed it all into the digital twinning. And again, I have lots of questions that are relevant and are relevant context to the conversation about rec centers and favelas and how it fits into current youth culture. But none of those conversations can be had if people will not engage. And I think actually Raul at Silicon Icarus actually has a piece, I don't remember the title, but specifically on surveillance smart cities in Rio. So again, all of this, and I will say, I think I might have a closing slide, but it's symbolic. I feel like the rollout of these programs, some of it is the economics of where the good investment opportunities are in terms of profit. And so, but the other piece is the social control piece. And I've said, and from one of the first couple of interviews with you, the first couple episodes, I talked about marinage, like maroon culture, the escaping enslavement in that tradition of creative removal from the system of slavery into swamps or remote areas where, you know, enslaved African people were still able to practice their cultures and their own community. That maroon model is very central in terms of thinking about how to address what's coming. And so, you know, the maroon culture was central in the Caribbean. It was in the US and Florida and the Dismal Swamp in North Carolina, but it's very robust in Brazil as well. And so when you look to see what communities are being targeted for being blockchained and for being corralled into the metaverse, I think it is significant that Brazil, with such a rich history of maroon culture, is a part of that and part of like this smart city surveillance web. And there you go. So we've got Omidyar. I think this is a few years ago, but they're working on, you know, civic technology. And I think this speaks to, if you listen to the interview, the full interview section, and I have it linked in the I uploaded a clip that was relevant to the rec center discourse, but the link to the full interview is in the description on my YouTube channel. And the full interview, the whole beginning was about censorship, but Omidyar Network has essentially has a whole program around journalism management, media management, and civic technology. And they want to say what good digital citizenship is. They want to prescribe what can be said, what quality journalism said. And I would say, even in that interview, Glenn Greenwald multiple times said, well, this person that I was arguing with, which wasn't me, it was someone who was like in the oil workers union, wasn't, I don't know, what is the blue tick on Twitter? Like, wasn't credentialed or wasn't registered. Like, I didn't know who that person was that I was arguing with. And so the idea of like digital legitimization and was something that's sort of on his mind. He was definitely identifying, like, if he couldn't identify for sure who this person was on the other end of the Twitter exchange, like he questioned the motives. Like he couldn't engage in the conversation. So the idea of civic tech, e-government, data analytics government, the smart cities is central, and Omidyar Network is clearly, working in the Latin America space, of which, you know, Brazil is a very large population. So we have to understand when things are not said. There's a lot going in the media that remains unsaid in the resistance to. The unsaid things, what is left unsaid, is often tells you as much about what's going on as the things that are.